Hey everyone, welcome to our first official South by Southwest 2022 interview episode. Today, it's our repeat offenders show, when we welcome back past guests who've been on the podcast before and have new projects debuting this year in Austin. We've got Miloš Mitrovic and Fabian Velasco, who we interviewed in person in Park City in 2020 for Slam Dance. And this year, they've got a new film called Horse Brothers. We've also got Alice Gu from CamFest 2021, and she's got a new documentary called Really Good Rejects. And last but not least, we've got Leah Shore, who was on with us at South by Southwest last year. This year, she directed the new Peaches music video, Pussy Mask. We also want to thank our friends over at Lost Republic for sponsoring our South by Southwest coverage this year and for being the official whiskey of the Bitch Talk podcast. You can visit them at their website at lostrepub.com. Now let's get on with the show.
Welcome to Bitch Talk, booze interviews straight from the heart of San Francisco. I'm Erin. That's Ange.
Hi.
That's Char.
Hello.
You can find us at bitchtalkpodcast.com where you can sign up for our monthly e-news.
For behind-the-scenes videos and two-minute clips of our interviews, head to our YouTube channel and subscribe.
You can find us every other Thursday morning at 9:30 a.m. at BFF.fm.
And if you like what you hear, rate and subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts. For the love of God, do it. It really helps. We are so excited to bring back on the show for your second time, Leah Shore, who is the director of Peach's music video that might be the favorite, my favorite thing I've watched so far.
Yep.
South by Southwest.
The
song's called Pussy Mask. And Leah, we're so happy to have you back. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, we were so super excited just to see your name pop up. And we remember you bringing this up the last time we interviewed you for Puss at yeah. South by Southwest last year. So for our audience, can you just give a brief description of the Pussy Mask music video for Peaches?
Well, I just think, you know, it's a time capsule of the pandemic, and it's about masking up, but a really funny tongue-in-cheek satire music video that Peaches made. The song, it's really good. Everyone should see it. I don't know if I should ruin it too much, but there are like lots of vaginas in it. And yeah, you should see it.
I appreciated the different colored vaginas.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Me too.
Representation matters, seriously. How did this happen, Leah? How did this meeting happen?
Great question. I directed an episode for Josh like years ago. Josh isn't, I don't think, a company anymore. I'm not sure, but it's this comedy company that produced a ton of content. And I directed an episode called like Worst Roommates Ever, but like not criminals. It was an animated thing, and I was fortunate enough to have a Peaches story, and we just, you know, befriended each other after that because I think we have like similar ideas in art and life. So we just stayed in touch for years, and then she, you know, shared the song with me during the pandemic. And honestly, I'm thrilled that I got to do this because it like saved my mind, my depressed mind. You know, everyone's depressed in the world, but it definitely was a great distraction for me. And it was a lot of fun. Yeah.
It is so much fun to watch. And I'm curious, was it always going to be animated, or were you maybe going to have a claymation pussy or a mechanical pussy?
Oh, great. Also, great question. I also make live action films. So I was just like, oh, maybe it could be crazy live action. I don't know. But she really was leaning towards animation. And I was like, okay, fine. For you. Okay. You know, I had a crew of like, Rob Yolfo animated it with me, and John Harrison did VFX on it. And that was it. Like, that was my crew.
Yeah, I was gonna ask, I mean, this video writes itself with her lyrics.
Yeah, totally.
but how much input did she have? Were you guys kind of working in tandem, or is she just like hands off? I trust
you. She was she like was very trustworthy with me. I mean, like we briefly talked about ideas and then at some point she was just like, run with it. And I storyboarded it, you know, and then, you know, she loved it all. It was like very easy. Yeah.
It was a match made in heaven, Leah. It definitely seriously.
Was. It definitely was. I hope to make more things with her.
Yes, the two of you joining forces is just perfection. And Peaches is a true wordsmith. I mean, we've loved her forever. One of my favorite lyrics of hers is, you can pat my Ben, pat my Ben, pat my Benatar. So I'm curious to know what is a favorite lyric of yours, Peaches?
Oh, no.
I
mean,
this song alone, yeah, I kept writing down lines like, oh, that's my favorite. No, that's my favorite.
Yeah, it's probably from just this because I've listened to it so many times. Like, I don't know how many times I've listened to this song. So probably something. My favorite lyric in the song is Pussy Not Karen, not Karen. You know, that's pretty great. Yeah, she's a wordsmith. I don't know. The mother of WAP, you know.
Literally. Yeah. I'm like, what are you talking about? Listen to Peaches, you know. Truly. Learn some history, kids.
Yeah, she like inspired everyone, I think. All modern day feminists, I think. Artists, you know. So,
So has anyone else that's kind of in this video seen this video?
Oh my god, I kept tagging them, you know. Fauci, AOC. I don't think they've seen it. They should. I would love to see like a reactionary video of them watching it. That'd be kind of amazing.
Okay, yeah. Well, keep us posted because I mean, AOC in particular, I feel like she'll respond. Yeah.
I feel like she would
she'll
like
give
it.
A shout out.
I feel like they would both like it. And but you know, who knows? I don't know. How can we make this happen?
I mean, it's gonna be at South By, so
yeah.
Maybe they'll see it that way.
Word is gonna spread. Yeah.
Something's gonna spread.
Literally. Okay.
It's also touring around America right now there's Dan Savage hosts a curated sexy film festival called Hump. So it's playing there too. So everyone can see it.
Mm-hmm. Do you think Fauci goes to that?
I highly doubt that. Unless he's promoting safe sex. I don't know.
I would hope so. That man needs a break. Anyway, the last time you were on was a year ago and we were commiserating over our thirstiness during the quarantine. Yeah. So I just wanted to take a second to catch up because, you know, how are you doing? It's been a year.
I'm good. You know, hanging in there, always seeking out some strange. nothing's changed.
Are you going to South By?
I am. Yeah. Are you guys?
Oh, good.
No.
We're the only ones not going.
No, like I have to go because like just to see this crazy music video play next to like Little Nas X and like Dua Lipa is gonna be hilarious. Also because they have like super huge budgets too, so it's like it's amazing that they programmed this, you know, on so many different levels. Yeah,
I think it's perfect. It fits right in, and you're gonna get so much love. I mean, and hopefully some strange. I mean, how are you not gonna?
Never know. You never know. My heart and loins are open. Experience.
Who's gonna take care of your cat?
Great Boy question,
George.
Where is he? I don't.
How is he?
My roommate. I have a roommate. He's really good. Let me hear it.
Yeah, I want to see him.
Yeah.
It always has to be a part of the interview.
Yeah, oh, and look at Koki. Koki just creeped in. Oh, Leah, you have to see Aaron's dog, Koki, just snuck it. She literally snuck in when you said that, Limber. That was hilarious.
Well, because she's sun drunk. She's been sitting in the sun.
We don't know how long he'll stay in my arms, but.
Oh, look, there's that mush face.
George.
Hi, George. Look at Leah. Look at Aaron's dog, Koki, just poked in right when you left.
There she's right there.
Oh, they look cute together.
Aww. Yeah.
They're actually really similar with the flat face. And
totally.
Half black, half white.
Yeah, I have the pug of cats.
Oh.
Yeah. I actually got him after I made a music video for Gina Volpe called Don't Touch Your Face. And it's just a cat punching things and being angry. But it definitely inspired me to get him.
Yeah. I swear, I love how your brain works. Seriously.
It's good. And you just are working your ass off. You're just a South by Southwest regular at this point. What's coming up for you? What are you working on?
Like film festival wise, or like,
or just
like,
film wise, or creative wise, or
I'm starting. You know, it's really hard to make a feature film, but I'm trying to get that the ball rolling there. It's in its baby stages. So I'm just, you know, trying to perfect the script, and then we will see. But I really think you guys would like it. It's a horror movie.
Yes.
It's a comedic horror movie.
So, perfect. Yeah. Just we'll have you on no matter what. Just come on. Maybe we'll just go to New York and interview you in person.
Let's grab cup.
Yes. Let's go hunting for some strange together, Leah, because Aaron used to be my partner in crime and now I have no one. So
got married. Yeah, I got hitched. Sorry. Sorry, guys.
It's okay. We forgive
sorry,
you.
Guys. Sorry to all the men out there. No, Leah, I think we would make a good duo. I'm just saying.
Definitely.
We're planning a trip to New York soon because we have some people to meet up with. So hoping that happens soon in the future. But in the meantime, I hope you have a great South by Southwest. Thank you for stopping by with us again. We've been talking to Leah Shore, director of the magnificent Peaches music video, Pussy Mask. Check it out. Wear a mask, find some pussy, and have a good day.
Yes.
I don't know. It just came to me.
It was great. That should be your slogan.
Yeah. I mean, we're going to now rebrand. So
thank you.
Wear a mask and find some pussy.
And have a nice day.
Yeah. Oh, yes, I do. Yeah.
That's important. Yeah. Because you can still have a bad day even after you find a mask and some pussy.
Welcome to South by Southwest 2022. We are here with two guys that were on our show a couple of years ago before the planet went to hell. And we're just really excited that they're still creating really interesting, mind-bending films that every time we see them, we're like, yeah, yes. They're filmmakers Miloš Mitrović and Fabian Velasco. This film's called Horse Brothers. And the last time we talked to you, about Tapeworm. So welcome back to the show, you guys.
Hi, thank
Hello.
You.
Hi.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, of course. We saw your names and we had to. So I'm going to go with Miloš. Can you tell the audience what Horse Brothers is about?
Horse Brothers is a short film that's really like a funny, weird thing that me and Fabian made. That it's about these two brothers who live on a farm, and I play one of them, and my horse tells me that my brother is pinching money from our sales of broken iPads, so I concoct a plan to kill him, and craziness ensues.
And just as with, I'm pretty sure I asked you this when we were interviewing you for Tapeworm as well, but were any drugs involved in the creation of this story? You know, maybe, or I mean, just how do you pull these?
Just sertraline, like Zoloft. Nothing else, unfortunately. I think that we pitched this to like Disney or like Fox had this thing, bite-sized horror shorts. And we just pitched a bunch of ideas like right before COVID started, like a week after or 2 or 3 weeks after Slamdance. And pretty much we didn't get it. And then we were like, oh, let's make the horse movie anyway. And then we've been making it since, I don't know, the fall of 2020.
Yeah, we filmed in April. We started filming April 2020 and we're still editing it until a month ago.
Wow. So this is something you guys have been working on since we saw you last?
Yeah,
pretty much.
I have to say that we had like a long lockdown. Like we had a lockdown from October all the way up until maybe April, where like it was like crazy. You couldn't, like, it was like everyone was sick and stuff like that. So we couldn't do anything. We literally couldn't do anything for like October, November, December, January, February, March. I'm really bad at math. That's like 7, I think.
Close enough. We get the point.
Yeah.
Well, tell me about the involvement of the horses. Have you ever worked with horses before? Did you know someone with a horse farm? What was that experience like?
No, we never worked with a horse before. And after this terrible shooting, I don't think we would work with them again. We rented a place that was, I don't know, we paid like so much money for like 4 hours of shooting. And it was just hard to get a good reaction from the horse. It kept moving around and we couldn't even get it was tough. In the edit, pretty tough to find a good shot, you know, to cut to the horse, I guess. But.
And I was going to say, this film's a little bit, obviously, based on The Godfather.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is that a huge influence on both of you or?
Not really, but we always like, for some reason, we always quote it and then we're always end up talking about The Godfather. But I would say the biggest one for this one was The Lighthouse. If we're talking about movies that we're trying to rip off, I think that The Lighthouse was going to be probably the one that kind of triggered the movie. And then we added all these other references and.
Well, I wanted to know, because you work together a lot and you both are writers, directors, and editors on this. So can you talk about your process together? Like whose strengths are where and where do you butt heads? I want to know about all the drama behind the scenes.
Oh, there's always drama. There's constant drama. Just kidding. I don't know. I guess what you say, Fabian.
Well, for this one, the biggest drama
that might get us into a
I don't want to say anything. I don't know. I think Milos comes up with a lot of the dialogue, like on set, because we always end up. I mean, tapeworm was different because that one was fully improvised, I think. But for this one, we wrote a script, and I wrote a bunch of dialogue. But then that ends up completely changed on set because we end up like joking around too much, and then. That will be funnier than what we have on the script. And then I think Milos came up with a bunch of that. And then, I don't know, I think I came up with a bunch of like the visuals and the edits and like the graphics I did a lot that weren't really, I did a lot of, like I ended up re-editing quite a bit of this stuff and then I added a bunch of graphics that were not really supposed to be there. I guess.
Yeah, and I act in the movies and stuff. That's always fun, so.
The biggest drama that came out of this shooting was Milos imposing a mask mandate in my own apartment.
So I had a mask.
Because we shot in my apartment and we had only like four people in the crew and then Milos was really adamant that we all wear a mask.
Here's the thing. Masks weren't a thing at that time though. It was
they're
like
starting. Though.
Yeah, like no one wore masks until like October. So when masks started, you know, that's when it was like, okay, we got to wear the mask. Even though, like, we didn't wear the mask the day before.
No, I know. Like, it made no sense, but for some, yeah. It's just.
So how have you guys been since the, you know, pandemic started? Because, you know, we all saw each other last when the world was great and everything was all good. And everything. Then, bam, everything crashed and burned so quickly.
Well, we were trying to figure out, that was 20 or 19?
Was it 20 or 19? Sundance.
2020 early. Like, it was literally January 20. Late January 2020 and then March.
We've been doing a lot of this, thank God for Zoom. So we were still able to continue with Bitch Talk. And I feel like this has been keeping us sane.
Yeah. I mean, the world's different. A lot of things have changed in our lives. But we're here. So I guess that's good.
Yeah. And it's
isn't it crazy? It all comes full circle that now we're at another film festival and we're talking to you folks. Isn't that fun? I find that very interesting.
Well, I love it. And I'm just proud of filmmakers like the two of you who are able to still make shit happen during a fucking pandemic. I mean, it's not easy to be an independent filmmaker, period. And then you throw in a pandemic and it just adds a whole other complication to. So it's just so cool to see you still working, you know, and not letting it stop you from being creative.
Yeah, it's, I don't know, we're always joking around a lot, so I think that's where it comes from, is sometimes when we joke around, we're like, we should make a movie out of this funny joke that we created.
Yeah, you don't want to do anything about the pandemic, or are you already?
What do you mean?
Well, it's like kind of, a movie.
Yeah, I did, yeah, I made
you
one.
Did?
Yeah, with Alex from Tapeworm, it's called Wasting Time at the End of the World.
Oh.
we couldn't do anything. So it was just me and her. And we filmed this movie where she's a comedian who is doing stand up to a Zoom call when that was weird, you know. Now that's normal. But back then it was like, look at what's happening. The Zoom. Now we're always on Zoom. It's not even that interesting anymore. But you should check it out. We see Fam at the End of the World.
All right.
On No Budge or something. It was good.
Well, I was gonna ask too, are you guys heading to South By? Or
yeah.
No?
Yeah.
Oh, you guys are?
Oh, cool.
Yeah, we'll be there on Thursday.
Okay. Well, that'll be exciting. Have you guys been traveling to film festivals, or is this the first one?
No, it's the first one since Utah. So okay. I can't wait to wear a mask on the plane for a while.
So it's a long time. You have a thing with the masks, Fabian. It's okay. You'll be all right.
I'm paying an extra amount of money so I don't have to sit beside anyone because I get really claustrophobic. And now, because I'm very germophobic too, you know, I am very germophobic. So on the plane, I'm going to be like, because I vowed when COVID happened to never go on a plane again. I'm never going to leave Winnipeg ever again. But I felt like I had to go to Southwest. So it is what it is. What can you do?
Yeah, we decided not to.
Maybe yeah, next year. But we're super jealous because so many filmmakers are like, oh, we'll see you there. And we're like, no. We're the losers that are staying home.
You guys are based out of San Francisco, right?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah.
You guys get to be in San Francisco, which is pretty awesome.
It's not too shabby. It's not too shabby.
Come by and have a drink with us, seriously.
Yeah, stop at SFO. Yeah. We'll grab a drink.
Let's go to happy hour sometime and we'll show you. Yeah.
Really cool. No, I've never been to San Francisco. I've been to Los Angeles many times, but actually once only to Los Angeles. When I was like a kid, but San Francisco, I've always wanted to go, you know. Austin is a great place. This is why I want to go. Is Austin is such a great place, I can't wait to check out so many cool Austin things that I didn't check out the two other times that me and Fabian went. Like there's this Daniel Johnston exhibit that I want to go see, and where they shot the Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie.
Oh, sweet!
That'd be awesome. Are you going for the run of the festival or just for the opening weekend?
We go always ahead, try to go for the full festival, and then by the second weekend we're like, oh, I can't do this anymore. So like for this one we tried. Also like I don't know about Milish, but I don't have the most money to be traveling right now. Mm-hmm. So we try to keep it fairly more accessible than going there for like, I don't know, 10 days or whatever.
Well, we've never been. Do they have the same amount of like free events and free cocktail happy hours and stuff that Sundance has and free food?
We got invited to a bunch of parties, I'm assuming.
Yeah, go to the free parties.
I'm so freaked about the parties though. Like,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You know, since the pandemic happened, I haven't been doing drugs, drinking, eating crappy food. I've been going to sleep early. I don't know how this is going to pan out for me because I'm no party animal anymore. Like, I used to be a party animal. Can't wait to go to a film festival. Now I'm kind of, you know, nervous that I'm going to be the party pooper.
Or you're going to be the life of the party and Fabian's going to have to drag you out of all of these events. Yeah,
exactly.
We'll be all on the lookout for the news then. Coming.
I'll be watching your Instagrams, both of you, seeing what's going on. Well, I just want to say thank you for coming back onto Bitch Talk. It's been a pleasure seeing you both again. We have filmmakers Miloš Mitrović and Fabian Belasco from the film Horse Brothers at South by Southwest 2022. Have a great time, you guys.
Thank you.
We are excited to welcome back to the show director Alice Gu, who has directed a documentary called Really Good Rejects, and it's for South by Southwest 2022. And it's another welcome back to the show to another one of our guests. We just had two of our other guests on that we had at Sundance 2020. So it's really good to see some familiar faces. So welcome back, Alice.
Yes. Thank you so much for having me. I'm so, so pumped to be speaking with you ladies.
You too. If you can do us a favor and tell our audience what Really Good Rejects is, it'd be great.
Oh gosh. You know, Really Good Rejects is a little hard to put into like one sentence, but if I were to try, Really Good Rejects is about a luthier. For people who don't know what a luthier is, it's a stringed instrument maker. So he's a guitar maker in Los Angeles by the name of Reuben Cox. And he started off as, you know, he's this kind of unlikely hero. He's like the unsung hero of these artists and musicians whom we love and adore, names that may seem familiar to us, like Phoebe Bridgers or Taylor Swift, The National, My Morning Jacket, Sleater Kinney. He is the kind of guitar guru behind a lot of their instruments. But I would say more than that, it's also about, the movie is really a vibe. You know, I can't say it's about like a cradle to grave and Reuben is very much still alive, but it's not, you know, it's not that kind of a story. It's really about a vibe out there. It's about feeling human. It's about connectivity. It's about what makes us feel a certain way. And from the very beginning, when it was kind of hard to put my finger on what exactly it was about, I would tell people that it's about magic. It's about the magic, for, you know, if that doesn't sound too cheesy, but that really is what it's about.
I'm glad that you describe it that way, because I was feeling emotional watching it. It's just the intimacy that you share with, you know, just, they're a famous musician, sure, but it's just a person and an instrument, but it's so much more. It's so intimate, and their description of it is kind of like a love story or a dance. I'm not sure, you know, how to describe it, but the same with Donut King. You like to throw a lot of different elements into the film. There's like sort of animation and all these different aspects of, because you're visualizing music. So can you talk about just the ideas that you came up with to sort of visualize something that is audio?
That was another thing too. And I would say for this film, different from The Donut King. The Donut King, I used animation because there was just a lack of archival period. You know, if anybody who's listening had seen it, you know, it's about Ted Noy and a bunch of Cambodian refugees who had fled and had to leave earthly possessions behind. And maybe if they had photographs, they were long lost and destroyed. And how do we tell this story visually, you know, and have something interesting for our viewers to look at. And this one too, it's different, but I didn't have archival for this one because they're talking about describing a feeling. You know, they're talking about like kind of a representation of what's in their hearts and what notes look like and what a certain song means to them or what it felt like. And so it was actually a little tricky to come up with an animation style for this one, because I'm like, it's not, I didn't want it to be literal. It had to be representative and very abstract in that way. So, and for viewers who see the film, some of that magic and kind of that stoke that I wanted to capture, like there's a line from Aaron Dessner of The National in the film where he says, he's like, hey, you know, I'm 44 now, but when I'm playing, I can feel like a kid again. Mm-hmm. And I feel like if we can all be so lucky to tap into that enthusiasm, that stoke and that energy when we were a kid. So I wanted the animation to be very rudimentary and almost childlike. Mm-hmm. So people see, it's very different from Donut King animation. This is like kind of continuous line and it's like stick figures almost.
Well, I was going to ask, how were you introduced to Reuben?
So I am friends with Ruben's wife, Miwa Okamura, who is also featured in the film. I've been friends with Miwa for years and Reuben, you know, but pretty close with Miwa. And I knew that Reuben had a guitar shop. They're both very humble people. And, you know, she's just like, you should check out the shop. It's really cool. And he does some cool instruments and for cool people, you know, and leaves it pretty vague like that. And, you know, I just got kind of busy and I was like, oh, you know, Reuben's shop is really interesting and cool. He makes guitars. And it's something that, although I'm somebody who's always been very connected to music and instruments, I'd say this was a really fascinating dive for me to go into what goes beyond a piano or a guitar. I say piano because that's what I played growing up. And Miwa sent me an article over the summer And it was about Ruben and these rubber bridge guitars that he, you know, he's very modest. He says he didn't invent it, but he kind of did. And it's by putting a little piece of rubber across, you know, over the bridge of a guitar, and it completely changes the way the guitar sounds. And you know, instead of sounding like a ringy, chimey sound of guitar that we're used to hearing, it flattens and it kills all the sustain. It's a very flat and dead sound for the strings. And she sent the article, and it included Blake Mills, who's in the film. He was kind of like, he's the father of the rubber bridge. And it had him playing a riff, and it did something to me. I this little clip, I watched it 20 times over and over again on loop, because the sound was just, it did something to me. It was so incredible. And the article, again, Ruben and me were so humble, but in this article it said, oh, his guitars are on Bob Dylan's new record and Taylor Swift. And, you know, it named all of these people. And I was like, Mima, I had no idea. And it started, I said, joking, not joking. I said, I feel like I should do a little mini documentary about Ruben. And she said, you really should. And I was like, should I? Would he be up for it? And she's like, totally. And it really just happened very organically like that.
Yeah, he still is, even in his interview, so unassuming. And I just love his temperament. And speaking of the musical legends that you got to interview for this, were you nervous before speaking to certain people, or did you reach out to some people that you couldn't get, but you tried to for the doc?
Ruben is such an exceptional human, and he's gone above and beyond. And this is what I hear from Miwa, because I'm like, Miwa, everyone is saying yes. You know, everybody wants to participate in this film, and some huge artists. And she said, well, Ruben goes above and beyond. He always delivers. He never asks anything in return. He never calls them and says, oh, can you put me on the list? Like, he never asks for anything. And I think this is maybe the first favor, anything that's come from Ruben, like, hey, do you think you could come and speak in this documentary? And hands out, every single person in this film said anything for Ruben. I'm so glad someone's finally doing a documentary about Ruben. It's so well deserved. I mean, this has been all across the board from all artists in the film. And I don't know, it all kind of happened so furiously and so quickly. Like, I would get texts from Ruben, and he'd said, Carrie Brownstein is in, Jackson Brown's in, Aaron Dessner says he's in, Jim James says he's in. I'm like, oh my God, you know, and then you just kind of go. And it was also tricky. We were filming still during COVID. Mm-hmm. And after a year like 2020, when all concerts and all tours and everything were put at a, you know, they were all stopped, all these artists were so happy to be, everybody was touring again. This was last summer. And I was like, hey, do you think you can come speak with me? And they're like, oh God. They're like, if anybody gets COVID, the entire tour, like all the wheels will come off the bus. And so everybody to be very careful. And even then, I can only imagine a grueling tour schedule. And they're like, well, they only have 7 days off between, you know, they've been touring for a month and then another month. And that's how much Ruben means to them. They're like, but yeah, we'll make time for you. And Jim James, right in the middle of a My Morning Jacket tour, you know, he came to meet us in a park. And I don't know, we were just kind of there. And then we interviewed him in this park, and he was this most, more on that later, but he's this incredible human. And as he drives off, we're like, okay, all right, that's it. You know, we kind of like left the release and like some sanitizer. We're like, you can go sign over there, you know, and we'll keep our distance. And as he drove off, like, I elbowed my DP and I was like, that was Jim motherfucking James. I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, you're just in it. And then later you just kind of realize, I'm like, that was Jim motherfucking James. Mm-hmm. Like, this is so cool. Like, we're at Long Pond Studios with Aaron Dessner. Like, this is where like a big Disney special, the Taylor Swift folklore, you know, like that was, it would dawn on me later kind of how mega and how cool and how giddy I felt inside.
I liked the interviews with obviously with men and women, but the men, when they're talking about music and how it affects them and, you know, what was their first memory of music? I mean, Jim talking about the Muppet Show was so sweet. I was like, I love all of these guys.
Like, so emotional.
Yes. Yeah. So sweet. Was it surprising to you to get those kinds of interviews from them? Jackson Brown. I mean, geez.
It was. And Jim in particular, I mean, who doesn't love Kermit the Frog and the Rainbow Connection? And
I looked it up after the movie and had to listen to it. Yeah.
it brought me back to my childhood too. With my piano being the instrument, I remember getting the sheet music to Rainbow Connection because I had this big thing with Kermit. About Kermit. I tried to get Kermit. Kermit's a really hard one to get. I was like,
wow, that was the one no, was from Kermit.
That was the one no. I was like, do you think we could do a Kermit and Jim James duet? But maybe later. But it was such a delight. And I almost don't want to give it away because I'm kind of embarrassed about it. But if you watch the film and you listen very carefully, you can hear me, because I couldn't hide my delight. I'd be like, wow. You know, I would like whisper, wow, or I'd be like giggling and chuckling. I was like grinning ear to ear, because they were such intimate conversations. To be able to ask questions that were kind of like I didn't think about this until later. I shared an early cut of this film with a friend of mine who was low hanging fruit. I mean, she was huge music head, big follower of like 90% of the artists in this film. And she goes to like every concert on every continent and like reads every article. And she called me after, and this was an early cut, and she called me. She was like, I cried 3 times. I'm like, okay, I don't think it's that good, but I'm glad you cried 3 times. And she was like, I cried 3 times, you know, this time. And she said, you know what? I've been following all of these artists as super fans for so long. She's like, I have never heard them speak like this, because you hear them on interviews, they're usually promoting an album or a certain something, and you kind of hear the same thing. Oh, why did you write that song? What did this song mean to you? But you never talk about them and their childhood, or what the music means to them, or what it was like to practice and be intimate and alone with the guitar, what it was like to maybe not feel like you fit in this world, and music was your ticket out. And it was incredible and super inspiring. And I felt like it was something that people, I certainly needed to like replenish serotonin in my own soul and body after feeling like maybe disconnected from people after a couple years of this pandemic, to not feel like alone, or this, I feel like music is something that can really help you feel like you're understood if you are feeling alone. If that's making any sense, or if I'm rambling on and on here.
No, you're right, Alice. And that's what I was saying in the beginning. It was cathartic for me to watch, and I wasn't expecting this emotional reaction to the story. But yeah, my favorite parts of the film are when they just start playing out of nowhere. You know, they'll be like, you know, because sometimes I'll do, and they're just like, it's the most beautiful thing you've ever heard. And they're just riffing. Like,
oh, they're artists.
It's insane.
Yeah. I felt like I was just in awe of like being, without sounding too much like a fangirl, I feel like it's more than fangirl, but like being in the presence of like a true artist and unicorn, like someone who, I can't write music. This is a skill it's probably like one of the farthest skills from anything that I have. And I'm like, you make that. And I asked them, like, are you channeling from like a spiritual dimension? I'm like, how are these beautiful melodies coming out of you? And it still never ceases to mystify me.
Yeah. I have one more question, then we need to wrap. But the other character out of your documentary for me was Mark. the hunter and gatherer. I mean, is there a side project with that guy? He was really
interesting. Oh, I love him. Thank you for paying attention to Mark, the hunter and gatherer.
Well, I thought that was his band name first, but I was like, oh no, he really is.
Happened to me a few times because I'm not hip to all the bands.
Yeah, I don't know everything. So he could be some guy in this band that I don't even know.
Hunter and gatherer. Okay. And when we were sound mixing the film, my sound mixer was like, and I noticed, you know, he says this to Ruben. He's like, here's this Japanese banjo. I'll give it to you for 100 and a half.
Yes.
And we're like, 100 and a half. Who says that? But I'm like, we're totally like intrigued by him. This guy is incredible. Yeah, Ruben's like, hey, if you want to get to the shop, he's like this guy, he looks like Doc from Back to the Future. And he just comes and his crazy van is filled with stuff that he's driven all up and down this state and other states looking for these old treasures. And he knows what he's looking for. Oh, I love that you love Mark. That makes me
so happy. Are you kidding me? I want like a little like short film about Mark. I'm sure he's got stories and that van has stories.
I think you're onto something. And shirts. I mean, shirts with his image. I mean, this could be a Mark, whole thing.
Hunter-gatherer.
It's kind of like a Yeti looking kind of guy. 100 and a half.
Who says that? Yeah. Anyways. I don't know, but he does. I love him. Thank you so much. We've been speaking with director Alice Gu. The film is Really Good Rejects. It's premiering at South by Southwest 2022. So happy to have you back on the show, Alice. Come back anytime.
And congratulations, really.
Thank you so much. I'm so happy to see your faces. And I hope we can make this a regular thing.
Yeah, well, you're hard at work. You keep spitting them out. So every time we see your name, we're going to be like, come back.
Yeah.
Everything you do, please. Yeah.
Thank you so, so, so much.
If you like what you hear, rate and subscribe wherever you listen to podcasts.
For more information about us, you can head to bitchtalkpodcast.com.
This podcast is created, hosted, and executive produced by Aaron Lim.
My co-host is Angela Tabora, a.k.a. Captain Party.
The show's edited by producer Shar.
We're powered by GoTo Productions.